next issue of the EIR, there is a new paper, an article by Lyndon LaRouche entitled "The Wells of Doom." And Wells refers to H.G. Wells, who is, for those of you who are familiar with him, he's best known or popularly known as a science fiction writer. But Wells was not a science fiction writer. He was a lackey of the British oligarchy. And in this article, what Lynn deals with is the are the roots of the countercultural revolution which took place in this country during the 1960s and 70s. That is the shift in cultural values which took place, and how this is the major problem we are facing today politically if we are going to get out of this crisis. Now, what I have prepared is a two-part briefing, of which you will get the first part tonight and the next part at our next meeting here, which before the end of the night we have to decide when that's going to be, because it can't be next Thursday. Next Thursday is Christmas. We'll figure it out. Andrea, if I forget, why don't you bring this up at the end of the meeting? So tonight is the first part. And the tonight, I'm going to give people a little bit of a sense of what's in this article with Lynn. But then primarily, what I'm going to present tonight is a briefing that I have prepared from some material dealing with the 1950s, 60s, and 70s. And I think people will find it a little bit interesting, maybe provocative. And then at the next meeting we have here, I'm going to deal directly with the article by LaRouche on the material that Lynn presents in his article, and which I'll really just kind of touch on tonight. I would just say two things. First of all, you know, we have mentioned before here the question of what LaRouche refers to as the baby boomer problem. And this has been brought up at numerous of our meetings. Some people might be tired of hearing about it. Some people may wonder why we talk about it so much. What's the big deal? You know, why is this even being brought up? Well, I hope between tonight and the second half, whenever our next meeting is, that the importance of this issue will become apparent to people. Everyone here is either a baby boomer, has a parent who's a baby boomer, or has children or nieces or nephews who are baby boomers. I would hazard that guess. So this is not something which is irrelevant to anybody. The other thing that I would just say is that is to ask people, to make a request of people, because I'm going to present a fair amount of historical material, and I would make a request of people that they not deal with this material academically or formally, but to in reflecting on some of the ideas that are presented, to take those inside of yourself and to think about how this relates directly to you on a fundamental level. The problem with dealing with the baby boomer issue is that people want to hold it at arm's length and deal with it academically. And if you do that, you're not going to get anywhere. And so that's a request I would make of people as we go into this. As Lynn said in discussing our upcoming conference, Lynn and LaRouche, the conference we're having in January and the importance of that conference, 1998 is going to be the year in which the future of our civilization is determined. And that is the situation that we're faced with. that is the reality confronting everyone in this room and confronting, in fact, the entire American public. Now, I wanted to just, I'm not going to go into a lot more details of the of these international developments, because the briefing I have for you is fairly long. But I do want to just go back to situate what I'm about to say. I want to go back to the article that by LaRouche that was in this EIR, the December 5th EIR, which we still have copies of in our literature room. This was discussed at the at a previous meeting, I believe. This is the article entitled, "So the Mountain Will Come to Clinton." And this was written by LaRouche in response to what occurred at the APEC meeting in Vancouver, Canada, the Asian Pacific, the meeting of the Asian Pacific government leaders, and the failure of that meeting to use the opportunity of that meeting to address the crisis that we're in, and in particular the failure of the Clinton administration to take to seize the opportunity of that meeting with the various government leaders who were there, to take the initiatives that are required, or to begin, at least to begin to explore initiatives to deal with the onrushing crisis. And LaRouche wrote this response to the meeting, essentially dealing with the failure of leadership that occurred there. And I'm just going to read to you about three or four paragraphs out of this. It's 3 pages long, but I'm going to read to you just a couple of excerpts from it. It goes as follows. The essential outcome of the Vancouver meeting of APEC is the refusal of the President of the United States, President Clinton, to visit that mountain referenced in the famous speech of the Reverend Martin Luther King. That mountain has a way of dealing with those who attempt to ignore it, as President Clinton did before and during the APEC conference. Soon, that mountain will visit President Clinton. This time, he will not be able to pretend to ignore it. There is a characteristic behavioral peculiarity among the majority of baby boomers, or in Europe, the so-called 68ers, and their children. This sort of negation was typical of the existentialist transvaluation of values which dominated the student population of our universities during the passage through the Vietnam years of 1964 to 1972. Here in the United States, this pathological trait is expressed commonly by the expression, "don't go there." The President of our United States, like all heads of state, is confronted by two horrifying choices. On the one hand, he is confronted by an ongoing, rapidly accelerating process of disintegration of the world's entire financial system. I believe that he now knows that this is the worst crisis this planet has known in all of modern history. There is no way in which this present system can be perpetuated longer than a very short time. It is as doomed as the sinking Titanic. Nothing could save it. On the other hand, the kinds of protectionist New Bretton Woods, Hamiltonian measures which could prevent the passengers of that Titanic, the nation, today's nations and their populations, from going down with the doomed ship, would provoke a murderous rage against the president from the most dangerous killers on this planet, the British monarchy-dominated Club of the Isles, the insider's name for that London-centered international financial oligarchy and its lackey. The apparent White House reaction to this dilemma, when someone says, let us discuss publicly the worst financial crisis in modern history now hitting us. Their response, don't go there. In respect to all among those contributing causes which make the present international financial crisis systemic as opposed to cyclical, the origin of the present crisis is changes in cultural values which are introduced to a majority among students as the 1964-1972 university campuses. These changes, away from the tradition of fostering investment in scientific and technological progress for increasing both the productive powers of labor and for demographic improvements in households, are the entirety of the distinctive causes for a systemic world crisis at this time. It is the persisting influence of these cultural changes during the recent 30 years which is entirely to blame for the world's present state of misery. That is the source of the most relevant external pressures. The two generations called in the United States Baby Boomers and Generation X, which now dominate the adult population and its opinion formation, are the internal peer group pressures faced by nearly every member of those two generations. The myth of the Golden Generation is typical of the most deadly expression of those peer group pressures. So, with that, I'm going to get into the presentation on what Lynn is referring to. I'm going to begin by reading a couple of other things from him. I know that it's a little bit difficult to follow things that are being read, but I want to make sure that this discussion is situated exactly the way it needs to be situated. I already did read that. So, I'll just get into the discussion, all right, into the presentation. So the, this stuff I'm sliding off here. Let me just read one thing again, actually. One little part of this. I emphasized it, but I'll just reread it. It is the persisting influence of these cultural changes, that is the cultural changes that took place between 1964 and 1972, and their persisting influence during the recent 30 years, which is entirely to blame for the world's present state of misery. Now, there are some people here who may not agree with that. There are some people here who may not quite understand what Lynn is talking about. So that's what I want to get into. I want to just begin by referencing the situation that existed in 1945 at the end of the war. Some people here are old enough to remember that. They lived through it. Others heard about it. But the essential thing is that what was the dominant culture? What was the feeling among the American people at the close of the war in 1945? Well, the primary thing was a sense of great optimism. America had just won an enormous victory. A victory over two powerful enemies, Nazi Germany and Tojo's Japan. We had done that. It had been an American victory. Everyone knew that. America was emerging from the war in a situation, in a position to essentially dominate the post-war era. And it was clear to everyone that if we could do what we had done between 1941 and 1945, that essentially anything was possible for this country to accomplish in the post-war era. You had the plans of Franklin Roosevelt for the post-war era. Now, this is something which maybe most Americans didn't know about, it's clear what Roosevelt's perspective was. This is laid out in the book by Roosevelt's son, Elliot Roosevelt, As I Saw It, and it is not just, it has been corroborated in enough other sources, documentary sources, that it's clear this is not just Elliot Roosevelt's personal view. That Roosevelt's plan, and he spelled this out in a number of talks, in a number of meetings with Winston Churchill and elsewhere, Roosevelt's plan for the post-war era was to put an end to colonialism, to abolish the British Empire, the French Empire, the Dutch Empire, the Portuguese Empire, to liberate all of the colonies, not to allow the British and the French to go back in and reoccupy their colonies, to go into these countries, and to develop these countries, to work with these countries as partners, to develop them with American technology, with American know-how. And in fact, Elliot Roosevelt reports on one meeting between Franklin Roosevelt and Winston Churchill, where Franklin Roosevelt lays out a map on the table, a map of Africa, and starts showing Churchill on the map where in all of these British colonies, former British colonies, the United States was going to go in after the war, where they were going to build dams, hydroelectric projects, schools, universities, roads, ports, and basically help these countries enter the modern era, enter the 20th century. That was the potential. That was what was possible. And everybody knew it. I want to actually just read to you the opening stanza from a poem by Friedrich Schiller, a poem some of you might be familiar with called The Artists, which was written at another point of optimism, written at a time in the wake of the American Revolution, which Schiller was a great supporter of, in which Schiller at that time expressed the hope for what he saw as the emergence of a truly modern era where the potentiality of man could be realized. And it goes as follows. How beautiful, O man, your palm branch holding, you stand at centuries unfolding in proud and noble manhood's prime. With faculties revealed, with spirit's fullness, full earnest mild, in action wealthy stillness, the ripest son of time. Free through reason, strong through law's measures, through meekness great and rich in treasures, which long your breast to you did not disclose. Nature's own law, Lord, who loves your chaining fetters, who in a thousand battles trains your powers, and splendid under you from out the wild arose. Let me just read the first couple of lines again. How beautiful, O man, your palm branch holding, you stand at centuries unfolding in proud and noble manhood's prime, with faculties revealed, with spirit fullness. This is the image that Schiller had of man. Noble, proud, faculties revealed, free through reason. And he saw at his time the potentiality for creating new types of society in which that quality of man could be realized. Now, if you think about what was possible in 1945, the opportunity that was lost because of the death of Roosevelt to eliminate the British Empire, to eliminate these unjust systems, to rebuild the world with American system methods. That you have to get a sense of what existed at that point. Now, you also have to get a sense of what America represented. I mean, we'll go into this a lot more in the next presentation, where Lynn talks about this, where he talks about how Wells developed these ideas I'll actually just go into it a little bit right now. Wells was writing around the turn of the century and into the 1920s and 30s. H.G. Wells was not a science fiction writer. He was a member of the British Round Table, the Coefficients, the Fabian Society, together with Bertrand Russell, Alfred Milner, and others. He was a leading kind of paid agent or lackey of the British oligarchy. These were the geopoliticians. These were the people who developed grand strategy, among other things. And although I'm not going to go into it in depth tonight, beginning in 1901, Wells began to write a series of books. The first of these was called Anticipations. And in these books, what he lays out is a strategy to destroy everything the American Republic stood for. They recognized that the spread of what they considered to be the American virus, the republicanism and the nationalism that America represented, the tradition of Abraham Lincoln that America represented, was beginning to spread around the world. The economic policies of Abraham Lincoln were being imitated in Germany, in Russia, in China, in Japan, and the ideas of the American Republic, all men created equal, the ideas of national economy, scientific and technological progress, that this was a mortal threat to the British Empire and had to be stopped. In his writings, Wells developed a four-part plan for how this could be accomplished. Number one, the development of nuclear weapons, weapons of mass destruction. And he's actually talking about this before World War I. The development of nuclear weapons, weapons so terrible, that the world could essentially be held blackmail to them and could be threatened in such a way, could become so fearful that people would accept certain things. And one of the things, the second part of Wells' plan, the first is the development of these weapons of mass destruction, nuclear weapons. The second part is the implementation of world government. That is the abolishment of nation states and the implementation of world government. The third part of his plan was population control and Malthusianism. That is the reduction of population, and combined with that, an end to scientific and technological progress, an end to industrial development. No more transcontinental railroads. No more people like Henry Ford or the Wright brothers or Thomas Edison, the kind of thing that America had become known for. And then the fourth part of his plan, which gets right at the heart of the 1960s, is that under these conditions of nuclear terror, world government, Malthusianism, population reduction, and end industry and science, to keep the population in its place, to keep people happy, was the abolition of all sexual restraint, free love, and what Wells called sexual freedom. And that was the plan. And essentially what was done And if you look, well, if you look, for instance, at someone like Lord Rees-Mogg today, who we've discussed Lord Rees-Mogg, and his ideas that in the future, in the information society, what you will have is a society where maybe 5% of the population, maybe 10% of the population, will be educated sufficiently to run banks, to run securities firms, to run governments, to run the internet and the information society, and a limited amount of technology you need to keep that going. But the vast majority of the population, 80 to 90%, will have a future of menial labor, semi-skilled or unskilled labor, no opportunities. The idea of America that each generation could progress further than its parents to think would become a thing of the past. People would be relegated to this kind of, you know, what they used to call the proletariat in the old days. This is kind of underclass, right? And if you think about that, think about Rees-Mogg talking about that today as the future in the pages of the London Times in 1997, and you think about what we're seeing in terms of sex, drugs, gambling, and all these other things, keeping people happy under those conditions, those degraded conditions of no future, keeping people happy through erotic pleasure. Right? This is what Wells lays out beginning in 1901 and through a series of books going into the 1920s and 30s. And this is a direct attack on what the United States had stood for. If you think, for instance, what, you know, besides the, you know, if you think about what America represented to most people, it represented Thomas Edison. It represented Henry Ford. You know, it represented, you know, the Wright brothers. It represented this tradition of scientific progress going all the way back to Benjamin Franklin and his circles and the experiments in electricity. Right? So this is something unique to the United States in history. This is embedded in our culture. Without this, the United States doesn't exist. This is the United States. And this is exactly what Wells set his sights on. Now, I'll read you a quote from H.G. Wells. This is from his autobiography. Just so you know, I'm not making all of this up. In a world where pressure on the means of subsistence was a normal condition of life, it was necessary to compensate for the removal of traditional sexual restraints. And so my advocacy of simple and easy lovemaking had to be supplemented by an adhesion to the propaganda of the Neo-Malthusians. This I made in my anticipations, 1901, the same year that the last president consciously in the tradition of Abraham Lincoln was assassinated, McKinley. And I continue to write plainly on this subject in a period when Neo-Malthusianism, was by no means the respectable movement it has become. So, this is what we're going to talk about. Now, I'm going to begin. I have a bunch of overheads here. We also have some audio. This is a multimedia presentation tonight. Because we all know about baby boomers, right? If you don't have pictures and music, they either leave or their mind drifts off into fantasy life after about 10 minutes. You know? Now, I'm going to go through all this, so just keep in mind. What I want to do, though, is go to 1945. I'm not going to necessarily go through all this in the order it's on here. So just, if you could follow the order in which I'm discussing it. Go to 1945. The atomic bomb being dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. This brings us into the nuclear age. The other obvious event in 1945 was the death of Franklin Roosevelt. With Roosevelt out of the picture, Roosevelt's post-war perspective immediately ceased to exist. Roosevelt's plans for the post-war era no longer function. You had a manipulable dupe who then became president, Harry Truman, a horrible president, who was manipulated into using the atomic bombs, which people like Bertrand Russell and others were demanding that they be used. The this enters in the nuclear age. Now I'm going to get into that a lot more, but let's think about what happened between 1945 and say 1948. Roosevelt dies. The post-war Roosevelt plan is scrapped. Truman, through being manipulated by the British and British allied circles in this country, essentially moves this country with Britain as our, quote, you know, our ally, our special relationship with our cousins, the British, moves us into the era of the Cold War, right? So we move immediately into an era of confrontation on a global scale. We developed nuclear weapons in 1945. The British developed their, exploded their first nuclear bomb in 1949. This then creates a situation of
the Soviet Union
in 1949. This creates a situation of thermonuclear terror, which very rapidly escalates in the 1950s. 1946, 47, you had a severe economic recession in this country, which did two things. First of all, it combined with the death of Roosevelt and the lack of leadership after the war. This played a major role in destroying the optimism that existed among the returning soldiers in 1945. It also hit at something very sensitive to the returning veterans, which is the fear of a depression. You have to realize that all of the World War II veterans had lived through the Depression. They had seen the economic mobilization during the war. They had come back expecting peace and prosperity, and then confronted with the possibility of another recession or depression. What's the immediate response of most people? I'm never going to, you know, I'll do anything, not have to live through another depression. I will do anything not to have to do that again. Right? And you had, you know, very quickly what, you know, whatever was on the minds of the returning soldiers in 1945 and what they thought might be possible under U.S. leadership after the war, what very quickly became the case in 1947, 48, 49, and 50 was the obsession with material security, with saying that, you know, most of them came back to young wives, most of them had children right away, and getting material security, financial security for my family and my children, right? This developed in the 1950s, and in the 1950s you had, you know, the pursuit of material, you know, of financial and material security. You had, you know, people, the flight to the suburbs, you know, the suburban lifestyle, the houses, you know, the cars, the consumer credit, you know, keeping up with the Joneses. You had the development of kind of a gray, monolithic society in which everyone was just kind of working to get ahead. Everyone was just like each other. You had, you know, the development of what became known as the organization man. You know, they actually made a movie about this called The Man in the Gray Flannel Suit. You know, the organization man, you know, in which, you know, everyone is, you know, is just part of the machine. And in fact, they had an expression for it at that time. It was called the Beats, the so-called Beatniks had an expression for it. They called, what they were doing, they called it railing against the machine. And that's been revived today. Actually, I was told there's a rock group called Rage Against the Machine. You know, everything that the so-called rebels today are doing is really a pathetic imitation of what was going on in the 1950s. I mean, really a pathetic imitation of it. Recycled beatnik slogans, you know. But, you know, this was the atmosphere. You had McCarthyism brought in, beginning with the House Un-American Activity Committee hearings in 1948, right? Which was followed up shortly thereafter by the McCarthy hearings, you know, which went on for about 5 years. 5 years in which people were terrorized. And the message was, you do anything political, you speak out, and this is what's going to happen to you. This is what we're going to do to you. And they made examples of people. Blacklisted them, put them in prison, destroyed people, drove people to suicide, executed the Rosenbergs. Right? And they terrorized people. And they said, keep your nose clean, do what you're told, move to the suburbs, get a house, you know, live, you know, the normal American life, you know, be happy with material rewards, or this is what we can do to you. And that's what the veterans did. They bought into it. You know, when in discussing the baby boomers, it has to be made clear that the World War II generation is not blameless in this situation by any stretch of the imagination. But that was the environment that existed in the 1950s. Now, a couple of things on the timeline here, because we're just going to go through some of this. I'm going to kind of take you through a walking tour of the 1940s, 50s, and 60s. 1946, two very important events. Mass production of television begins. The one-eyed babysitter for the children of the World War II veterans. Within a matter of months, millions are being produced. Within a couple of years, tens of millions of Americans have television. Right? The same year, Benjamin Spock publishes his book, Common Sense Book of Child Care, which ushers in the era of permissive child rearing. The first children's show premieres in 1947, Howdy Doody, and runs, in fact, for 13 years, 5 days a week on television. I mentioned the House Un-American Activity Committee hearings. Also in 1948, the first Kinsey Report, Alfred Kinsey, Sexual Behavior of the Human Male, is published, ushering in the era of discussing sexuality and sexual liberation. And one of the major features of this report was the assertion by Kinsey that a substantial percentage of American men were homosexual. This was followed in 1953 by Kinsey's second book, Sexual Behavior of the Human Female. I can't tell if that's focused without my glasses.
It's not.
The Soviet Union detonates its first nuclear bomb in 1949, so both superpowers have nuclear weapons. In 1951, I just stuck this in there. In 1951, there was a movie that came out called The Day the Earth Stood Still. Has anybody here seen that movie?
Yeah,
a bunch of times.
This was an absolute. I mean, this movie could have been scripted by H.G. Wells himself. I'm not going to go around recommending movies to people. I recommend people first read Lynn's paper on H.G. Wells, and I recommend you see this movie. It comes out right at the time of the development of nuclear weapons by both superpowers. And the theme of the movie is that an alien visits the United States, comes to the Earth, and the alien, I won't go through the plot, but the alien tells, the most famous scene, or the most important scene of the movie, is the last scene, the last 10 minutes of the movie, because they assemble all the world leaders, all the presidents of the nations and other people, And the alien gives a speech to them. And what he says is, you have to end nuclear research, put an end to this, and you have to submit to world government, and if you don't do this, we will annihilate you. Right? And the movie could have been scripted by H.G. Wells. Most people who saw it probably didn't realize what they were seeing. What you were seeing was propaganda. Propaganda for the cultural paradigm shift. 1953, the first explosion of a hydrogen bomb. Much more powerful than the bombs at Hiroshima and Nagasaki. We'll discuss that a little bit further. Also in 1953, the first legalized tranquilizer is introduced, Thorazine. 1954, the first rock and roll hit, Rock Around the Clock, Bill Haley and the Comets. Scientology is founded in 1954, spinning off things like EST and other organizations, the beginning of these personality development cults. Let me get back on this doors of perception, because we're going to be discussing the drug culture quite a bit. 1940, the first thing up here, which I didn't mention yet, Aldous Huxley introduced to hallucinogens by Aleister Crowley, the Satanist. Hallucinogens, you know, are things like LSD, you know, psilocybin, mescaline, things like that. And Huxley, if there's anyone here who doesn't know who Aldous Huxley is, he is most famous for writing a book called Brave New World, which was required reading in a lot of schools in the 1960s. The book was essentially put over on the American public as a vision of the nightmare future, the nightmare society which might come about. When in fact, that is not true at all. This was not a vision of a warning against where society was headed. This was a blueprint on the development of such a society. And anyone who doubts that, you know, should look at what Huxley did in the next 20 years, in which every single thing he did makes it clear that this is exactly what he was doing. So he begins experimenting with hallucinogens in the 1940s. In 1954, he writes a book called Doors of Perception, which is about his experiments with hallucinogens. You take a mind-expanding drug and you go through the doors of perception. You become enlightened, right? This book was read by millions of people on college campuses in the 1960s. This became one of, a major bestseller, so to speak, with the counterculture and the development of the counterculture in the 1960s. And the rock group, The Doors, took their name from this book by Huxley. Also, The Lord of the Rings was published in 1954, the fantasy book of much less importance than Doors of Perception, but what's interesting to note about it is that it essentially was a failure as a book until the 1960s, when again it was picked up by the drug culture and people in the drug culture as this kind of fantasy life book. It became very popular in the 1960s. Okay, 1955, the first government-mandated national air raid drill, nationwide air raid drill in the United States, the entire country at the same time had an air raid drill to prepare for thermonuclear attack. Right? I want to go through this because it's important to realize, you get back to what Wells was saying, how through the development of weapons of such horrible capabilities of mass destruction, you could terrorize a population into abandoning the traditional values of that culture. You could terrorize a population, you could manipulate a population, and you have to understand is that this is what was going on in the 1950s. Some people here lived through it, some didn't. Some may have forgotten. So the first mandated national air raid drill was in 1955, and just to switch to the bottom here, in 1960, you had the seventh national air raid alert. 160 million Americans participated in that. And many people here probably remember, I remember it very clearly. We had air raid drills all the time when I was going to school. And you know, that you know, you would have a drill, hide under your desk, you know, whatever good that's going to do you, but you would hide under your desk, and the idea was this ever-present possibility that, you know, the country could be annihilated, that everyone could be killed. This is not academic. It's not something you read in books, you know? And that's what the environment was during this period. Now, to go back to 1955, you have Elvis Presley signing with RCA, an unknown rockabilly artist who signed with RCA, thus ensuring him of becoming a superstar, and massive hype is given to create him as the first great rock superstar, right? And by 1957, American Bandstand is on television 5 days a week. American Bandstand was not on once a week. It was on Monday through Friday, right after kids got home from school, right? Bringing rock and roll into the living room of every household in the United States that had teenagers, right? Disneyland opened in 1955. The Mickey Mouse Club went on TV in 1955. Also, 5 days a week. 5 days a week, it was on. Tens of millions of people saw it. Catch-22 was published 10 years after the war. What's the message of Catch-22, a truly despicable book? The message of Catch-22 is that World War II was wrong. War is meaningless. We shouldn't have fought it. That's the message of Catch-22. You know, there's no truth in what's going on. You have an absurd situation. You have black comedy, call it comedy, cynicism is a better word for it, in which the so-called hero of the book is trying to find a personal way out from this horrible situation. There's nothing about what the war was about, the defeat of Hitler. This is left out. It's that the war is absurd and meaningless, right? A book, obviously, which was, as many people here can attest, was extremely popular with high school and college age youth in the late 50s and all throughout the 60s. Now, what I'm gonna talk about a little bit are the Beats, or as sometimes they are known, the Beatniks. Because this was really everything that developed later, except for the hallucinogenic drugs, everything that developed later in the 60s came out of the Beat movement, all of it. And it's important to understand how this was all developed. You had a Cold War. You had a society of organization men. You had a sense of the country drifting, right? And what you had through sponsorship, very high up. For instance, what ensured the big splash on the scene for the Beats was when Jack Kerouac, one of the leaders, published his book On the Road. It was given a front page glowing review in the New York Times Review of Books, thus guaranteeing its success and putting it on the map, so to speak. Now, the Beats first emerged to public. They had been around. Kerouac actually wrote On the Road in 1951. It wasn't published till 1956. And in fact, there was a book published in 53 by William Burroughs called Junkie, a really lunatic book, which had also been out, but they were unknown. What the first thing that brought the Beat movement into public awareness was a poetry reading in San Francisco in 1955, the so-called Six Gallery reading. This included many of the leaders of the Beats, Allen Ginsberg, Jack Kerouac, Michael McClure, Gary Snyder, many of these people were there. And this was this poetry reading got a lot of publicity. And within a matter of months, you had magazines like Life and Newsweek and Time talking about the new Beat movement and the new literary poetry movement coming out of San Francisco and Greenwich Village, right? This was where, this Six Gallery reading is where Allen Ginsberg read his first famous poem, Howl, right? Which is, I don't know if anyone here has ever read the entirety of Howl. I've read it. I do not recommend it. It is like taking a trip through Dante's Inferno without having Virgil along to show you the way out, right? It is a really disgusting piece of trash. But anyway, the what I'm going to do for you is play you a little bit of the Beats. I have two excerpts of Jack Kerouac, and then I have Allen Ginsberg reading the opening stanzas to Howl. So, now, let's see here. Which one is this in? Hope the tape doesn't break. I had to retape these because the tape broke. If it breaks again, I'm going to be in deep trouble.
We try to get to the
deep. Okay, here we go. First is Kerouac, Jack Kerouac.
Right on the road.
An existentialist sense of the individual, living within a meaningless society. The idea that truth does not exist, that society is unfathomable, and the only true meaning can be found in individual experience, personal experience, and the idea that you live moment to moment for the thrill, for the sensation. Right? And in fact, I'm going to read you a little excerpt from Kerouac's book, On the Road. This is Jack Kerouac with Neil Cassady. Kerouac is this one, and this was his best friend, Cassady. Cassady also later became, well, we'll get into that. Some of you here might have heard of the Merry Pranksters, Ken Kesey and the Merry Pranksters. Cassady drove the bus for Kesey, right? And was at all of the acid tests. He made the transition from beatnik to hippie pretty smoothly. So this is from On the Road, to give you a sense of it. He's describing that he and Neil Cassady, who in this book is Dean Moriarty, and Kerouac is Sal Paradise. This is an autobiographical book, he just changed the names. But they had just arrived in Chicago as part of a cross-country trip. And it goes as follows. We headed straight for North Clark Street after a spin in the loop to see the hoochie-coochie joints and hear the bop. And what a night it was. Oh man, said Dean to me as we stood in front of a bar. Dig the street of life, the Chinaman that cut by in Chicago. What a weird town. Wow. And that woman in that window up there, just looking down with her big breasts hanging from her nightgown and her big white eyes. Sal, we gotta go and never stop going till we get there. Where are we going, man? I don't know, but we gotta go. Then here came a gang of young bop musicians carrying their instruments out of cars. They piled right into a saloon and we followed them. They set themselves up and started blowing. There we were. And, you know, this was the situation, and the, you know, you had, you know, the same, very same year as the Sixth Gallery reading, you had the film Rebel Without a Cause was released with James Dean. Some people have seen that, which because of the fact that he died before the movie was released, this instantly became like a cult classic of, you know, the, this idea of either meaningless rebellion against society or rebellion against a meaningless society or meaningless rebellion against a meaningless society. But this idea of existential, living for the moment, living for the day, the society around you is insane, and that this, the thrill, the moment, this is what is important. And then in 56, On the Road is published. The other thing which these guys were involved in, which led directly into the counterculture in the 60s, was Buddhism and Eastern religion. All of these guys, or almost all of them, got involved in Buddhism, some very heavily so. One of Kerouac's most famous books, Dharma Bums, is about Buddhism. Gary Snyder was a Buddhist, and Gary Snyder brought Alan Watts into their circle, who became very popular in the 60s. A lot of people here remember Alan Watts' books circulating in the 60s on Zen Buddhism. Ginsberg was a Buddhist. Michael McClure was a Buddhist. And these guys brought Eastern religion in as part of this idea, right? This idea that there is no truth in the world, there is no potential for the nation to have a mission, for the individual citizen to act constructively on the nation. But instead, it's through finding inner peace, inner harmony, finding truth in the, the momentary enlightenment, the flash of enlightenment, so to speak. And this was an intricate part of the Beats. One of the major people involved in that was Michael McClure, who was also one of the ones who read at the Sixth Gallery reading. And Michael McClure was most famous in that almost all of his poems dealt with animals and nature, right? And in fact, in an interview, he was quoted as saying that, where is it now? He was quoted as saying, when a man does not admit that he is an animal, he is less than an animal. Not more, but less. This is man. And at the, and believe it or not, at the poetry reading in 1955, McClure read a poem called For the Death of 100 Whales. Right? So it doesn't go back very, this goes back quite a ways. McClure later actually wrote the lyrics for a song which was set to music entitled, Oh Lord, Won't You Buy Me a Mercedes Benz? By Janis Joplin. That was written by Michael McClure, who was one of the key inner circle of the Beat movement. McClure was one of the key people with Kerouac and Ginsberg and Corso and the rest of these guys, Burroughs. Gary Snyder was a leading poet, a leading beatnik, a leading Buddhist. His poems were very popular in the 60s. I know a lot of people who read Gary Snyder's poems in the 60s. I used to own a couple of books of Gary Snyder's poems.
He wrote Turtle Island. Is that the Gary Snyder?
Yeah, that's him. That's the guy. He's still around today. And in fact, I'm going to read you a poem by Gary Snyder. It's called Rip Rap. Lay down these words before your mind like rocks. Place solid by hands in choice of place. Set before the body of the mind in space and time. Solidity of bark, leaf, or wall, rip-rap of things. Cobble of Milky Way, straying planets, these poems. People, lost ponies with dragging saddles, and rocky surefoot trails. The world's like an endless four-dimensional game of Go. Ants and pebbles in the thin loam. Each rock a word, a creek-washed stone, granite, ingrained with torment of fire and weight, crystal and sediment, linked hot, all change in thoughts as well as things. So that's, an example of what these guys were into. But the it's important to go through this because the Beat movement never became a popular movement. It was never a mass movement. But it was the testing ground for what came later. It was based on existential despair, rage against the system, the idea of the corruptness of America, the idea that the only meaning to life was personal fulfillment, whether through thrills or inner enlightenment, almost all of the Beats played, with a few exceptions, but almost all of them played a significant, if not leading, role in the creation of the counterculture in the 60s. Kerouac was the exception, but almost all the rest of them did. So we'll go back to the timeline here. Other developments. In 1955, one thing I didn't mention. The Rosa Parks Montgomery bus boycott, that's where Rosa Parks, the famous woman, refused to give up her seat, and Martin Luther King organized the Montgomery bus boycott. And then 2 years later, in 1957, the Little Rock Central High School incident, where the desegregation of Little Rock Central High School with the governor, Orville Faubus, trying to maintain segregation. These are in there for a specific reason. The myth of the golden generation, the myth of the baby boomers, that we are the golden generation. Our parents were hypocrites, our parents were corrupt, our parents were materialistic. We were the ones who brought about all these great changes. We brought about peace in Vietnam. We brought about the civil rights movement. Well, look, Rosa Parks refused to give up her seat, and Martin Luther King organized the bus boycott in 1955. The oldest baby boomer was 8 or 9 years old. The oldest. Most baby boomers were either still infants or hadn't even been born yet. And the same is true with the 1957 incident and the whole organizing of the civil rights movement in the mid to late 50s. The baby boomer generation had nothing, nothing, I'll repeat that, nothing to do with the civil rights movement. Nothing. And anyone who thinks otherwise is wrong. They're just, look, when the March on Washington in 1963, the oldest you could have been if you were a baby boomer in 1963 was 17. Now, maybe there were a couple of 17-year-olds and 16-year-olds in the March on Washington, but it couldn't have made up more than, you know, 0.1% of the people there. The civil rights movement was organized by returning World War II and Korean War veterans. That's who organized the civil rights movement. And this is one of the lunatic myths of the golden generation. So, now we start to move into the actual creation of the counterculture. 1958, Alan Watts takes LSD with Aldous Huxley. We've met Huxley before. Alan Watts was a leading Zen Buddhist. He actually wrote a book once called Beat Zen, Straight Zen, and Real Zen. But Watts' books were massively read on college campuses in the 60s. 59, Ginsberg takes LSD. Well, Ken Kesey first. Ken Kesey, who became the leader of the Merry Pranksters, takes his first LSD trip at Menlo Park Veterans Hospital. This is part of MKUltra, drugs supplied by the CIA. And Gregory Bateson was the guy who gave him the LSD. Bateson was the husband or former husband of Margaret Mead, who ran this project. He later was appointed to the Board of Regents by Jerry Brown in California. In the same year, Ginsberg is given LSD by Bateson. You have the founding of the San Francisco Mime Troupe. You have the founding of the San Francisco Mime Troupe, which played a major role in Haight-Ashbury and the Summer of Love. Lady Chatterley's Lover is published, which essentially is declared not obscene by the U.S. Supreme Court. This essentially legalizes pornography in the United States, right? In the United States. Think about Wells, right? The erotic paradise, the sexual paradise. You get people to give up their national sovereignty. You get people to give up their commitment to scientific and technological progress through eros, through sex and erotic pleasure, right? Ladies Chatterley Lover, pornography becomes legal. Naked Lunch is published, probably William Burroughs' most famous book. He's one of the Beats, another totally psychotic book. Dobie Gillis is on television. I mentioned that only because of the famous character of Maynard G. Krebs in Dobie Gillis, who was a beatnik and who essentially was brought into American homes every week, and the effect that this had on people. And in fact, once Bob Dylan wrote a song once called As Dogs Run Free. If dogs run free, why can't we, or something like that. And anyway, it had kind of a weird backup sound to it. And he was asked, how did you come up with this sound for this song? He said, I wanted that Maynard G. Krebs sound. You know, so anyway, it's just kind of a little anecdote. But anyway, 1960, you have the 7th National Air Alert. Also in 1960, you have the first oral contraceptives, which clear the way both for sexual freedom and Malthusianism. 60, Timothy Leary takes LSD for the first time. Growing Up Absurd, another book which was extremely popular on college campuses in the 60s, is published by Paul Goodman, basically with the same message. American youngsters are growing up in an absurd, contradictory, meaningless society. Summerhill has published a truly psychotic book about a radical approach to child rearing, which, you know, I won't even go into it. But and Leary publishes the Tibetan Book of the Dead, based on his experiments with LSD. This is the book that the Grateful Dead took their name from, which they stated openly they did that. I'm going to move right along here. 1961, Timothy Leary begins his LSD experiments in Harvard. The same year, John Kennedy launches the space program. This is the last gasp of America's, or the not the last gasp, that's not, I shouldn't say it. The last significant initiative by an American president in the realm of national leadership and scientific and technological progress. Another thing worth saying about this is on this question of the golden generation. What were the two greatest things that happened to this country? The two greatest things this country was involved in since the end of World War II. The two things that most define what is good about America. One is the civil rights movement, and the other is the Apollo space program. Put a man on the moon. The baby boomers had nothing to do with either of those two things. Nothing. Nothing. The civil rights movement was led by World War II and Korean War veterans. Bevel is a Korean War veteran. You know? And Bevel was young. Most of them were older than him. Space program was launched by John F. Kennedy, the first president, who was a World War II veteran. So in 62, you have a breaking point. The Cuban Missile Crisis. This is absolutely a key defining moment. If you think about this combined with the Kennedy assassination the next year, this is the turning point of America, 62 and 63. If you think about the Wells scenario, which he spells out as early as 1901, and using nuclear weapons and weapons of mass destruction to terrorize people into giving up their freedoms and abandoning their traditional culture, their commitment to science, technology, and those type of things. It's one thing to say that during the 1950s, with the air raid drills, with the hydrogen bombs, that people live day to day with, you know, with the possibility in their mind that there could be a nuclear war. But in 1962, something else happened during the period of the Cuban Missile Crisis. In 1962, people were convinced that there was going to be a nuclear war. Immediately, tens of millions of Americans and most American teenagers were not sure whether they were going to live out the week. Now you have to, this is not academic. When those Russian ships were approaching Cuba and we sent our boats to intercept them, most people in this country expected nuclear warheads to be going off. This was the type of situation. Look, this was the defining moment. This was a moment of sheer terror. the idea that you probably wouldn't live. Yeah, and this is what, look, anyone who lived through the 60s knows this. I mean, sometimes people kidded around, but it wasn't just kidding around. The idea that, you know, well, we should just do whatever we want, have as much fun as whatever we want to do, because we're probably not going to live to be 21. Yeah, sometimes people said it kiddingly. Sometimes you said it to a date in order to try to, you know, get a little sex out of her. You know, but in general, you know, it was real. You know, it was underlying. It was operating on the psyche. That we live in a world in which everything could be annihilated. Everything could be pulverized. Works of art, cities, people, culture. Everything that the human race had accomplished through thousands of years could be wiped out in a matter of minutes. This was the Cuban Missile Crisis. Terrified people. And the next year, Kennedy is dead. Right? In an assassination that shocked the country, that terrified the country, an assassination which was covered up. And then you have the supposed assassin of his, the man who was being accused of being the assassin, Lee Harvey Oswald, murdered live on television. Live! I saw it. I was watching TV. Guy comes out and shoots him. Bang! Dead, you know? The guy was, they have him in custody for killing the president. You have to realize the shocks. You cannot think about it academically. The emotional and psychological shocks being delivered on a very impressionable youth living through that. Right? Other things that happened during this time. The Esalen Institute was founded. I'll discuss that a little bit later. Silent Spring published, the first major environmentalist. This is the first Silent Spring, the attack on DDT. The first major environmentalist book published. Yeah, as a bestseller, The Attack on Modern American Agriculture by Rachel Carson. Bob Dylan's first album in 1962. The Port Huron Statement, the founding of SDS. Now, I'm going to read you a couple of excerpts out of the Port Huron Statement. Think about, these are the, 1962, right? You know, the baby boomers are now, a lot of them, some of them are younger, but the older of the baby boomers are now teenagers, or close to being teenagers, right? And you had the founding of SDS, that's Students for a Democratic Society. For those who don't know what that is, you remember in the 1960s, all the campus protests, like Columbia University and all that, 1968, these were all led by SDS, the Students for a Democratic Society. And this was their founding statement, the Port Huron Statement. This is actually written by Tom Hayden, believe it or not.
Tom Hayden, California representative?
Yes, he wrote this. He's a founding member of SDS. We are the people of this generation, bred in at least modest comfort, housed now in universities, looking uncomfortably to the world we inherit. When we were kids, the United States was the wealthiest and strongest country in the world, the only one with the atom bomb, the least scarred by modern war, an initiator of the United Nations that we thought would distribute Western influence throughout the world. Many of us grew up in complacency. As we grew, however, our comfort was penetrated by events too troubling to dismiss. First, the permeating and victimizing fact of human degradation. Second, the enclosing fact of the Cold War, symbolized by the presence of the bomb, brought awareness that we ourselves and our friends and millions of others, we knew more directly because of our common peril, might die at any time. Our work is guided by the sense that we may be the last generation in the experiment with living. Now, think about this. This is written the same year as the Cuban Missile Crisis. Think about this. This is a long statement. The goal of man and society should be human independence, a concern not with image of popularity, but with finding a meaning in life that is personally authentic, a quality of mind not compulsively driven by a sense of powerlessness, nor one which unthinkingly adopts status values. Loneliness, estrangement, isolation describe the vast distance between man and man today. Politics has the function of bringing people out of isolation and into community, thus being a necessary, though not sufficient, means of finding meaning in personal life. The political order should serve to clarify problems in a way instrumental to their solution. It should provide outlets for the expression of personal grievance and personal aspiration. And it goes on, channels should be commonly available to relate men to knowledge and to power so that private problems such as personal alienation are formulated as general issues. Now, I'm not making this up. This is the founding document of SDS. People who are familiar with SDS think of it as a leftist, sort of semi-socialist or semi-communist radical group fighting for leftist political causes, right? What have you got? You've got everything we've been discussing in terms of the culture coming out of the Beat Generation, the existentialism, the isolation, the rebellion against the machine of the faceless, meaningless society. Did they talk about housing for the poor, food for Africa? They talk about personal isolation, personal meaning in life, right? As the key issue of our time. And this was the group that organized every major campus thing in this country. It's out of this you get everything that was spawned off the campuses. Feminism and all this stuff, you know? Finding personal meaning in your life. Because after all, isn't that what we all believe? Isn't that what our generation believes and our children believe, the GX generation? Isn't that the most important thing in life? To have a personally meaningful life? To be personally happy? To be personally fulfilled? To have a fulfilling life? Isn't that the most important thing? Isn't that what we all agree to? So, I'm going to play you something else. Scrounging for your next meal. How does it feel to be without a home, like a complete unknown, like a rolling stone? How does it feel with no direction home, like a complete unknown, like a rolling stone? A complete unknown, no direction, without a home. How do you feel about it? How do you feel about your existentialist loneliness? Right? this is what a whole generation was brainwashed on. Now, the Esalen Institute, this picture is a little, I'll just look at it yourself. I'm not even going to explain to you what's going on there. The Esalen Institute was founded in 1962 in Big Sur, right here in California. The founders included Gregory Bateson, Aldous Huxley, Allen Ginsberg, Alan Watts, Michael McClure, and this was set up basically to explore new types of group therapy, consciousness-raising sessions, you know, various sorts of tea group, therapy groups, communal therapy, absolutely insane things like rolfing and primal scream therapy, you know, in which the idea is to return to the state of an infant. Return that you, you know, you return to the state of being a complete infant, of just feelings. You get rid of your mind, you get rid of your, you know, sense of reason, and you return to a state of primitive feelings. This was the first. And from 1962 on, this stuff spread all over the country. Today, it is embedded in our culture. Write a letter to Ann Landers, what does she say? See a therapist, right? Something happens, somebody gets killed, so something happens in school, what do? Send all the kids to see a therapist, right? This is embedded in our culture. One of the major ways this started was with feminist consciousness raising groups, right? And then to other things. Today you have the Promise Keepers, which are run on the basis of, essentially it's a male sex cult, a homoerotic cult, in which the identity of the male is located in his sex organs, and which is quite strange for a Christian group. And the they have these sessions where they all sit around, you know, these men. Talk about Jesus and the size of their penises, you know, it's pretty weird. This literally goes on, by the way. '63, the Kennedy assassination, and then Dr. Strangelove. Dr. Strangelove coming out less than a year or about a year after the Cuban Missile Crisis. Anyone who's seen Dr. Strangelove, it's a movie about the end of the world, about nuclear Armageddon, told as a black comedy. You know, again, I mean, black comedy was something which really took hold in the 60s, so-called black comedy. People like Lenny Bruce and this kind of stuff started in the 50s, you know. What's the whole thing of black comedy? Cynicism. Life is meaningless. There is no truth. There is no such thing as truth, right? And that's what this movie's about. It's a comedy about the end of the world, nuclear Armageddon. Right, very popular film in 1963. 64, The Triple Revolution is published. This was what did I do with my notes here? The Triple Revolution was published by the Fund for the Republic, headed up by Robert Hutchins. Through money supplied by the Ford Foundation. It included a lot of so-called leftists, people like Michael Harrington, Gunnar Myrdal, and others. And what they proposed, this is a seminal document, which was followed the next year by the Rappaport Report, published by the Tavistock Institute of London. What the Triple Revolution proposed is that, what they said is that we are now moving out of the era of industrial and scientific progress, moving into an era of services, of post-industrial society, and that all policy should be based on this. This was a very influential document at the highest level of policymaking. It was followed the next year by the Rappaport Report, published by the Tavistock Institute in London. And this was a report about American culture. And it said in the report that Americans and American youth suffer from what they called excessive technological optimism. That is, a belief in science and in what science could accomplish. And they said this had to be stopped. And one of the things they proposed in this report, in the Rappaport report, was the immediate scaling down and eventual shutting down of the U.S. space program. That is, everything which John Kennedy had fought for be shut down, stopped. And in fact, from 1966 to 67, that was underway. Even though we landed a man on the moon in 69, the funding for the space program was cut back, 66, 67, 68, and 69. We were already scaling back, and we were abandoning the plan to go to Mars. Other things, let's move through this kind of quick. One Dimensional Man, published in 1964. Anybody here read that? I've read it. This was, again, one of the most influential books on college campuses in the 1960s, particularly among leftist students, radical students, students involved in the anti-war movement. It's written by Herbert Marcuse, and what it said, it essentially is the same theme. We live in a society of one-dimensional men, gray figures, organization men, and the true liberation has nothing to do with, you know, development or, you know, third world development or things of that type, housing, schools. The true liberation is personal liberation, to liberate yourself from being a one-dimensional man, right? He then wrote another book, I think about 2 years later, called Eros and Civilization, which he makes the same point, elaborates it further. This book was very widely read on college campuses. The Merry Pranksters were founded in 1964. And in fact, here's a picture of them. This is Ken Kesey up on top. This is their bus further, which they took on cross-country trips across the United States. But in particular, it was used during 65 and 66 to go up and down California with the acid tests, the LSD distribution. And the driver of the bus was Neil Cassady, who had been the main character in On the Road and who had been Jack Kerouac's best friend, who later died of a drug overdose. The Merry Pranksters are founded in 64. And also in 64, you have the Beatles on the Ed Sullivan Show, the manufactured hysteria of Beatlemania. The Beatles, by the way, took their name from the Beat movement. This is not how you spell Beatles, like a bug. Bugs are spelled B-E-E-T. The Beatles took their name from the Beat movement, and 75 million Americans watched them on Ed Sullivan, setting off the whole British invasion and that whole thing. In 1964, the first baby boomers begin to enter college, the oldest ones. You ever wonder why Lynn talks about 64 to 72? Because this is the year that the first baby boomers begin to enter college. 65, the acid tests begin in California. For those who don't know much about this, what they did, LSD was legal in 1965. What they did was Kesey and the Merry Pranksters drove up and down the length of California holding what they called acid tests, where they would rent a garage or a hall, or an auditorium, or a gymnasium, and they would get hundreds or even thousands of teenagers to come, and in order to get in the door, you had to take LSD. That was the acid test. And in fact, they did put it in the Kool-Aid a lot of the time. It's not just a myth. But over a period of like 12 to 18 months. They literally turned on, so to speak, or drugged tens of thousands of California teenagers with LSD. This is how the drug culture started, the mass drug culture. This is how you went from the Beat Movement, which was never more, even though it had influence in a certain kinds of cultural ways, it was never a mass movement. Most, you know, teenagers in the 1950s thought the Beats were crazy, you know, if they knew about them at all. But this was the mass recruitment to the counterculture with the acid test. The most famous of these was the Trips Festival in San Francisco in January of 1966. This lasted 3 days. 3 days. And it was held at the Longshoremen's Hall down in North Beach. You know the one down there by Fisherman's Wharf? You ever been down there? Longshoremen's Hall, the big parking lot? That's where it was held. 3 days. Thousands and thousands of teenagers came to it. 3 days of nonstop psychedelic lights, LSD, what have you, rock music. The way they got the kids to come to these things, by the way, I mean, they didn't just say, hey, come to our gymnasium, we're going to give you some drugs, you know. The way they got them to come was they had very loud rock music, like a dance, a party. And that's how they got 14-year-olds, 15-year-olds, 16-year-olds, 17-year-olds to come. Rock band. The rock band was the Warlocks, which later changed its name to the Grateful Dead. It was the house band for the acid test. Jerry Garcia and the rest of these guys had all been given LSD very early on by Bateson. That's how they met Kesey, was through Bateson. Garcia was taking LSD at Menlo Park Hospital, just like Kesey. That's how they met. That's how they recruited kids to this thing. So, you know, you had the development.
So could you expand on that just a little bit? They had the music on site, but if the kids weren't in the neighborhood, how'd they get them down to the neighborhood?
Oh, they popularized these things. This is not something that they put up. They put up posters, flyers.
Okay.
They went to the high schools and handed them out. Okay. You know? Big party. The acid test. You man enough? You know? Come to it. So and they did it, you know. So you had the acid test begin in 1965. The Rappaport report is released saying shut down science, shut down the space program. Ralph Nader publishes Unsafe at Any Speed, the first which unleashes the consumer movement in this country. The purpose of which is to redefine the psyche of the American person as a consumer, as opposed to a producer. Think about Edison. Think about Henry Ford. Think about the Wright brothers. Think about the fact that 50 years ago or 40 years ago, most American men could fix their own car, right? That you were a producer. Most American men worked in factories or in mines or on railroads or in ports or were longshoremen. They were involved in a process of production of goods. And what was unleashed with Nader was redefining that psyche. You were no longer a producer. America wasn't going to produce anything anymore. It's all laid out in the Triple Revolution and the Rappaport Report. You were now merely a consumer. That's all you were. A consumer of goods which were being produced, you know, which were supplied to you to meet your felt needs. So the Trips Festival in January of 66, January 21st, 22nd. 23rd. Eve of Destruction, released in 1956. Some people here remember that. Oh, don't tell me there's no one here. Ned. Ned remembers it.
I remember that.
I remember it too.
Don't believe we're on the eve of destruction. Basically a song about the fact that the world is coming to an end. This song went to number one on the charts faster than any song in history. In history. Including Elvis Presley songs, including the Beatles songs during Beatlemania, right? And it's a song about the fact that we're on the eve of destruction. The world is basically at the verge of being annihilated. The Artist Liberation Front, founded in San Francisco in 66, this was associated with the Mime Troupe and also the Diggers. And these were the key groups organizing the Summer of Love. Masters and Johnson's publishes Human Sexuality in 1966. Right? Which takes the work of Kinsey much further, right, in terms of the whole unleashing of this idea of sexual freedom, right? Anton LaVey founds the Church of Satan. The Mamas and the Papas sing California Dreamin' in 1966, which, you know, had teenagers all over the United States, I'm sure in the snowbound Midwest, singing this song and dreaming about going to California. Going to California. Be safe and warm in California. You know?
It's about the time my dad went.
A lot of people went. And if they didn't go physically, they went mentally. 66, 67, you had the massive escalation of the Vietnam War. A generation terrorized by the Cuban Missile Crisis, now faced with going to fight a war in Vietnam that they had no desire to go to. More than 200,000 draft-age American young men fled to Canada to evade that war. So the stage is set by 67 for the Summer of Love, for all this to come together in the Summer of Love. Let's talk about that first. The human being. This is the great gathering of the tribes in Golden Gate Park in San Francisco. This is the high point of the Summer of Love. This is a picture here of Allen Ginsberg of Howl fame, now transformed into a hippie poet, with Timothy Leary on the stage of the human being. It was Leary, Ginsberg, McClure, Gary Snyder, and Alan Watts that led the crowd in the chant of Om, the Buddhist chant, right, at that festival. This went on, you know, they were just gone. If you never heard, I'm not going to do it. But, you know, the point is this went on for a long time, this chanting of Om. And, you know, McClure, Beat, Ginsberg, Beat, Watts, basically around the Beat movement, right? All of these guys. They, you know, this is how this stuff was organized. And they basically organized this thing, the Summer of Love. You had, the various groups I mentioned, the Mime Troupe, the Artist Liberation Front, the Diggers. You ever heard the expression, do your own thing? Do your own thing. That was coined by one of the leaders of the Diggers in San Francisco. Or the expression, today is the first day of the rest of your life. That was coined by the Diggers. 1967, right? This whole thing, this is where this stuff was organized. You had the whole counterculture unleashed. Scott McKenzie song, if you're going to San Francisco, be sure to wear flowers in your hair. You look at what was on the charts. This is actually wrong. California Dreaming shouldn't be there. But if you look at the charts, what was on the charts in 67, if you're going to San Francisco, be sure to wear flowers in your hair. I'm picking up good vibrations. Don't you want somebody to love? Which is from the Jefferson Airplane Surrealistic Pillow album, which also contains the song White Rabbit, which is about taking LSD. All You Need Is Love by the Beatles. Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band by the Beatles. This is unleashed on the youth of America in 67. Unleashed. Another key cultural turning, a key cultural thing is The Graduate, the movie The Graduate. This movie, some people might remember this, they did a study of this movie. Because what they found is when they showed it to audiences, None of the adults liked it. They didn't like it. People over 30. But the teenagers went crazy for it, right? Now, if you remember the movie at all, there's a couple of things about it. First of all, what's the movie about? The movie's about a guy who has sex with his girlfriend's mother, right? And he's the hero of the movie. And in fact, at the end of the movie, the girl marries another guy. He comes in after the marriage is completed, and she and this guy, who had been having sex with her mother, run off together and get on a bus, right? That's what the movie's about. It also has this famous scene where he's talking to this older guy in the movie about his future, and the guy says, I have one word for you, plastics. You know, the plastic industry has a future. And of course, this summed it up, right? I'm not going to be part of a plastic culture. I'm not going to be an organization man. I'm going to, my feelings, my needs. You know, I'll do whatever I want. I'll have sex with my girlfriend's mother. You know, whatever I have to do, you know, to find personal fulfillment. This movie was incredibly popular, The Graduate. Incredibly popular. I'm not going to go through all this stuff. Hair opened in New York. The Age of Aquarius. One of the people in the play, in the cast, was Barry McGuire, the guy who wrote Eve of Destruction. Rolling Stone was founded. The Monterey Pop Festival, the first big rock concert in history, 1967. March on the Pentagon, the first big anti-war demonstration, with, among others, Allen Ginsberg. R.D. Lang's book, The Politics of Experience, is published, another campus favorite in the 1960s and 70s, The Politics of Experience, which basically, R.D. Lang was a psychiatrist with the Tavistock Institute. And his basic theory is that we live in an insane world, and in an insane world, the only people who are sane are the insane. And he argued from the standpoint that insanity is sanity. Right? The first Super Bowl in 1967, for all you football fans there, this was part of transforming American culture into one of Roman Colosseum type spectator. Sports spectaculars, right? So you had the spread of counterculture ideas in 66 to 69 on the college campus. Some of the books that were popular. Hermann Hesse was republished. Hermann Hesse is a psychotic German writer whose books were republished in the 60s, books like Steppenwolf and others, massively circulated on college campuses. One of the more widely read was a book called Siddhartha. For those of you who don't know who Siddhartha is, Siddhartha was the founder of Zen Buddhism about 2,000 years ago. Stranger in a Strange Land, right? Very wide popular book. And in fact, Frank Zappa and the Mothers of Invention wrote a song based on that book. William Reich is revived. Reich was a former follower of Freud, he's a psychiatrist, who developed theories of sexual freedom. And he developed this whole theory of the orgone, which is not worth going into. But his books were revived and widely read. Sexual freedom. Now, look, I'm running through this stuff real quick. Think about this in terms of H.G. Wells. You terrorize people. You terrorize a youth generation. The arms race, the Cold War, the Cuban Missile Crisis, the assassination of John Kennedy, the Vietnam War, you terrorize a population, you get them to abandon their commitment to American Republican ideas, commitment to truth. Truth no longer exists. You get them to abandon their commitment to science and technology. You introduce a zero-growth Malthusian culture. And what do you keep people happy with? Eros. Eros. Occultism, the spread of occultism in the 60s, transcendental meditation, the Beatles went over to see the Maharishi, Gurdjieff, Uspensky, Theosophy, Buddhism, I Ching, this all comes out of the Summer of Love. Organic food cults, macrobiotics, you know, some of you may remember this guy here. There he is. Mr. Natural. Mr. Natural. Art Crumb, Zap Comics. Keep on trucking. Right? They now make for a screensaver for your computer. the original organic farmer, you know, all coming out of the Summer of Love. So you have this stuff. 68. Leary publishes the Politics of Ecstasy. Paul Ehrlich publishes The Population Bomb. The world is overpopulated. There's too many people. Malthusianism. The Beatles release Yellow Submarine. The film I Am Curious Yellow is declared not obscene by the Supreme Court. This legalizes pornographic movies. Up until 1968, pornographic movies were illegal in this country. This legalizes pornographic movies. You have the unrest on the universities led by SDS, the Chicago Democratic Convention. People remember that in 68, with the cops and Mayor Richard Daley and, you know, all the people who were there, Tom Hayden and all these guys. Ginsburg was there, by the way, and a bunch of these people were there. And then you have the assassination of Martin Luther King and Bobby Kennedy. You know, this puts the nails in the civil rights movement. The African-American population in this country has never recovered from this. Kennedy is murdered on top of his brother being murdered. You know, a insane world. The message is driven home and, you know, over and over and over again. 69, Woodstock and Earth Day. You know, Woodstock goes without saying. Earth Day, the founding of the first mass environmentalist march, right? 70, Sexual Politics is released by Kate Millett, the first major feminist track. You know, a woman, you know, our bodies, ourselves. Hands off my body, right? You know, the identification of women, you know, not with ideas and truth, but with their bodies, and with the fact that somehow women are, you know, are not part of the human race, you know, because, you know, there's no such thing as universal culture anymore. Women have their own culture. Jesus Christ Superstar, I'll go back to this. 1967, Turn, Turn, Turn. You see, remember this? Do everything through the season, right? You know, some people remember that. This is the Birds. This is important. Turn, Turn, Turn was important because this was based, this is a rock song, rock folk song, based on a book, a passage in the Bible. This opened the door towards bringing rock music into the churches, right? And I remember this. I had a
They brought that music into the church?
Not into the church itself, but we had a Catholic youth study group with some Franciscan brother, and he brought this in and played it to us. And discussed
really?
It with us. Oh yeah, oh yeah. This is the beginning of bringing rock music into the churches, and by 70 you have Jesus Christ Superstar, you know, this pagan orgy, you know. I'm gonna move along here. 71.
Can you hold for a second, Bob, and I'll change tape?
Mass propaganda drive for the idea of a post-industrial society, right? That's the third wave. You had the agricultural society, the industrial society. Now we're moving into the post-industrial society, the information age, 1971. 72, Limits to Growth, published by the Club of Rome, right? That we are running out of resources, that the world is winding down. You know, again, leading into the environmentalist movement. 72, Female Eunuch, another feminist book, this one by Germaine Greer, following up on the one by Kate Millett. World Without Borders by Lester Brown, arguing for the abolition of all national sovereignty, right? H.G. Wells, One World Government, Surrender of Sovereignty. NSM 200, written and drafted by Henry Kissinger and adopted the next year in 73 as official U.S. policy. What it says is that all U.S. policy towards third world countries will be based by law on policies of population reduction. Population reduction. Malthusianism. 72, the last Apollo mission to the moon. That's it for the space program. The Rappaport Report scenario is concluded. The Joy of Sex is published. You know, following up on Masters and Johnson and everything else. Now, hell, you know, you don't have to do anything. You know, there's enough stuff in this book to keep you happy for 20 years. The Unification Church is established in the United States. Roe versus Wade. Whatever you think about abortion, the point is that this you know, is a key part of the whole push for Malthusianism in terms of, if you look at the whole chronology of things that I went through. 74, the Bucharest UN Conference on World Population. John D. Rockefeller, Margaret Mead. This launches a global effort through the United Nations to reduce the world's population and to enforce those policies on countries all over the world. High Times magazine, founded in 74. 1975, Microsoft is founded, and the next year Apple Computer is founded, opening up the era of the whole information age, move into the internet, virtual reality, etc., etc. 79, Three Mile Island, and the China Syndrome. That's it for the nuclear industry, right? On putting an end to nuclear energy in this country. If you're going to finish off the space program, why not finish off the nuclear industry? So the I'm rushing through this because of the hour, but look, the look.
Take a vote.
What?
Like part way.
It's getting really cold up here.
All
right. Well, why don't you close it then? No. So look,
he's got this door.
Oh no! Close that door. You can probably leave that one
you
open.
You can leave the back one open if you just close it. That'll work.
So, look, what have you got here? What have we just gone through from 1946 to 1979, with the key period being from 64 through about 72? What you have is a total transformation of a generation. You have a generation which, I mean, if you think back to Wells, what Wells said, we're going to put an end to everything that America stands for by using nuclear terror to getting people to give up their national sovereignty, give up their commitment to scientific and technological progress. We're going to impose Malthusian policies of population reduction, zero growth, and we're going to keep people happy through sex, sexual freedom. Right. Now, this is what the baby boomers went through. This is what the reality, this is what exists today in the minds of baby boomers and their children, because their children don't know any better. It's an erotic delicatessen. That's what the world is all about. And you got to understand, eros is not just sex. Eros is object fixation, right? Think of a young child, a two-year-old. Think of a two-year-old who wants a cookie. Want a cookie, Mom. And you won't give him the cookie, because, you know, spoils appetite, right? And the kid goes bananas. The kid throws a tantrum. Starts kicking his arms and legs, starts screaming so loud you think your eardrums are going to break, right? He's fixated on that cookie. Wants to have that cookie. That's eros. Eros is not just wanting to have a sexual body, you know, that you can have contact with. It's object fixation. You ever see the bumper sticker, "He who dies with the most toys wins"? You know, that's eros. Life has no meaning. There is no truth. The only thing that matters in life is amassing the greatest amount of objects which give you personal pleasure. Now, one misconception you might get from what I went through is to think that this is all just this left-wing, counterculture, weirdo stuff. You know, you get people who say, I mean, one of the interesting things about baby boomers is that they're all in denial, you know? I'm not a baby boomer. I didn't take LSD in the 60s, or maybe just a little bit. But I didn't take LSD. I didn't go to sex orgies. You know, I only had sex with 17, 18 people. But you get this denial, you know, this denial from people, you know. I was always a conservative. I supported the war in Vietnam. I'm not like these people you described. That misses the point. What's the fundamental point? You go back to the 1950s. Go back to the 50s. and the creation of the organization man in the United States. The retreat from Franklin Roosevelt's post-war perspective. The retreat from the United States having a mission in the world, which Kennedy revived with the space program and the Alliance for Progress and other things. Briefly revived. 2.5 years, that's all he was president. And you think about, you know, the statement I read from SDS. You know, you think about the stuff from the Beat Generation, which then evolved into the counterculture, right? And the drugs. The most, that true liberation is personal liberation. Personal fulfillment. Just like the baby with the cookie. Now, it doesn't matter if you're a liberal, if you're a conservative. It doesn't matter. You think of Newt Gingrich, he's a baby boomer. Clinton's a baby boomer. Gore's a baby boomer. Janet Reno's a baby boomer. Right? Think of these people. It doesn't, left wing, right wing is meaningless. You have a generation which operates at the emotional level of a 2-year-old. You ask people, you know, I mean, if you really get down to brass tacks with people, what is the most important thing in their life? Personal fulfillment. I have to, you know, find myself as a person. You know, I don't like this. I mean, look at the divorce rates, right? I mean, you know, in the 1920s and 30s and 40s, you know, people would leave marriages reluctantly. Now, the thing is, maybe some of them should have. I mean, there were some bad marriages. But the point is that when the question of a bad marriage came up, the thing that people thought about first was, what about the children? What about the children? Today, what the 40-year-old baby boomer says is, am I happy in this marriage? Don't I deserve better? What about me? Me, me, me! That's the secret of the baby boomer. And it comes up all the time. All the time. It cuts through every political strata. It cuts through every walk of life. And it affects everyone who's under 50 years old. Everyone. There is a fundamental difference. There is a fundamental difference. The baby boomer's general orientation to his life and to the world around him is how it all relates to him, to me. Everything is conducted on the basis of that reference point. What about me? That's the baby boomer. And it's the same thing. Look, it's not just the left-wing weirdos, lesbians, gay rights activists. What about these fundamentalist Christians, the promise keepers? What's their shtick? You know, I am going to be personally saved. To hell with people starving in Africa. To hell with the fact that we are facing the biggest financial and monetary crash in history. I'm going to be saved. In case of rapture, this car will be unoccupied. You know, I have a, you know, have you accepted Jesus Christ into your heart as your own personal savior? Are you personally saved? Do you have a meaningful personal relationship with Jesus? Are you going to personally be raptured? I mean, Kabila is murdering tens of thousands of babies in Zaire. But look, I've got to save. I have to be personally saved. I've got to spend eternity with Jesus. This is the baby boomer. You know, and you get it all the time. Look, it comes up in the organizing. I mean, there's some organizers here. I'm not embarrassed them. But, you know, it comes up in the organizing where people are having a hard time organizing. And what they think about half the time, I'm not going to say this is what goes on all the time, what they think about is, you know, they maybe have a couple of days where they don't do too well in the organizing. And, you know, they get depressed. And most of the time what they're depressed about is, you know, my organizing was not very good. I'm blocked. I'm having a hard time. You know, I feel bad. I feel enraged. I feel demoralized because my organizing is not successful. As opposed to thinking about the fact of, you know, that the shortfalls in the organizing, that the first thing that comes to your mind is not how this affects you and your personal relationship, your personal state of mind, but that the shortfalls in organizing have a objective impact on our ability to do what we're doing in Korea and Germany and Russia and around the world. In other words, that the primary thing is the reality out there, as opposed to the inner mental map, psychological map of the baby boomer. So I'm gonna play you a few things now. We'll get right at the nitty gritty of the baby boomer generation here. No more kidding around. Addressing problems that exist in the world. You know, no sense of fighting for science and technology. It's just an erotic paradise where it's always howdy-doody time. You know? They never grew up. When I say that baby boomers have an emotional level of a three-year-old, this is not hyperbole, folks. I mean it. You know? People who want to feel warm, people who want to feel good, you know, people who want to love each other, you know?
No, not anymore.
Oh, yeah. We got some more.
Yeah.
an erotic delicatessen. Pick and choose. You know? You like sex with boys? Pick that. You want to be a promise keeper? Pick that. You want to be, you know, who knows what? Whatever object you desire, pick for whatever makes you feel good. Whatever fulfills your needs, you can have it.
Oh, please.
I'm not going to say much about that. This is to set up the next song, which is probably going to offend a few people here, but this is obviously the age of Aquarius, which, you know, the 60s, the drug culture, peace and understanding, enlightenment, all that stuff. This, some people may know, this is from the musical Hair, which premiered in New York City, I think, in 1967. I had it up there, 67 or 68, I think it was 67. And this was the, you know, most famous song from the play, but here's a song that's also from the play, which maybe you haven't heard before.
Masturbation.
Masturbation can be fun. A model of a generation. And there's one more. There's one more. Now that's from Tommy, the Who's so-called rock opera. If you couldn't understand the words, it's see me, feel me, touch me, heal me. Now you'll notice that there's 8 words there and 4 of them are me. And that 2 of the others are feel and touch. Right? You have to think this stuff through. You can, you know, this is not, you know, you have to think through what was done to this generation and the way it affects people. On a fundamental level, it's one thing to, get all this stuff academically. But you have to understand that our generation and the children we raised are crippled, emotionally and psychologically crippled. Our reference point to the universe has been twisted. You know, Lynn talks about Dr. Faustus, you know, and I think the Wells paper, one of these things, and the pact with the devil. You know, the abandonment of truth, the sexual delicatessen, the erotic delicatessen, the personal fulfillment, the pleasure, and the fact that everything relates back to you, to you. You are the center of the universe. People know how many. If anyone knows this, the answer, if anyone's heard this, don't say it. How many baby boomers does it take to screw in a light bulb? Only one. He holds the bulb, and the rest of the world revolves around him. Obviously today you have all these, you have a lot of things that stem from this. This, you know, I mean, this absolutely psychotic notion of empowerment, you know, I mean, which you hear all the time now. I feel empowered. You know, I mean, the world is collapsing. We are facing the biggest collapse of civilization in 500 years. But personally, you know, emotionally, I feel really empowered about my life. You know, the idea of victimless crimes, death with dignity, you know. You got this bumper sticker now. I'm not exactly sure who puts this out. Perform senseless acts of kindness and random acts of beauty. I mean, this is like the, you know, the recycled, retread, you know, summer of love crap, you know. And, you know, this is what people get day in and day out. People in Generation X have no concept of truth. None. They don't even have any concept that truth exists. They don't have any concept of what a nation is. You know, you cannot have an America without Edison, without the Wright brothers, without a mission, without things like the space program or third world development. America doesn't exist as a nation, and it won't exist. It will cease to exist. And people have, you know, but hey, you know, I want to feel good. What about me? So, to just kind of wrap this up, to get back to what Lynn was talking about in terms of the Vancouver Summit and this question of going there. I'm just going to read you a short quote from Hamlet's soliloquy, Shakespeare, from the To Be or Not to Be soliloquy, where Hamlet talks about, quote, the undiscovered country from whose bourn no traveler returns, puzzles the will, and makes us rather bear those ills we have than fly to others we know not of. This is the question with Clinton today. To take on a chip, that it's better to suffer with that. And this is the question, think of the American people today. Think of the baby boomers. Everything keeps getting worse. The schools get worse. The drugs get worse. The shows on television get worse. The jobs get worse. The bills get higher. You know? There's more, healthcare gets worse. And people sit there and they don't do anything about it. Now you can say, the media lies to them. The media tells them everything's fine. What are they, idiots? All you gotta do is walk out on the street and you know that things are worse than they used to be. You don't have to be a genius. But people sit there and don't do anything because they would rather bear the ills they have than to go there, than to act, than to do something. And, you know, this is actually the theme of almost all great tragedy. I mean, this is the theme of a lot of Schiller's plays, of Don Carlos or of William Tell, where the lead character is faced with a situation in which if he fails to act, like Hamlet, he will be destroyed. And everything he cares for will be destroyed. And he must act. Now, in Don Carlos, they don't. They're like Hamlet. You know, Don Carlos and the Marquis of Posa, probably related to Hamlet somehow. But in William Tell acts. He says, there is a course of action, and I must act. My personal feelings, my personal desires don't matter. I must act to do what has to be done. I must take responsibility for the future of my nation, Switzerland, for my family, for my town, for my society. I must act. And he acts. He does what has to be done. He goes there. You know, and I want to just conclude by reading you a couple of excerpts from John Kennedy, from a World War II veteran. The first is from his inaugural address, and the second is from his speech at Rice University on the space program. The world is very different now, for man holds in his mortal hands the power to abolish all forms of human poverty and all forms of human life. And yet the same revolutionary beliefs for which our forebears fought are still at issue around the globe. The belief that the rights of man come not from the generosity of the state, but from the hand of God. We dare not forget that today that we are the heirs of that first revolution. Let every nation know, whether it wishes us well or ill, that we shall pay any price, bear any burden, meet any hardship, support any foe, any friend, oppose any foe, to assure the survival and the success of liberty. This much we pledge, and more. To our sister republics south of our border, we offer a special pledge to convert our good words into good deeds in a new alliance for progress. to assist free men and free governments in casting off the chains of poverty. So let us begin anew, remembering on both sides that civility is not a sign of weakness. Let both sides seek to invoke the wonders of science. Together, let us explore the stars, conquer the deserts, eradicate disease, tap the ocean depths, and encourage the arts and commerce. In your hands, my fellow citizens, more than mine, will rest the final success or failure of our course. Since this country was founded, each generation of Americans has been summoned to give testimony to its national loyalty. The graves of young Americans who answered the call to service around the globe, surround the globe. Now the trumpet summons us again, not as a call to bear arms, though arms we need, not as a call to battle, though in battle we are, but a call to bear the burden of a long struggle, year in, year out, rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation, a struggle against the common enemies of man, tyranny, poverty, disease, and war itself. Can we forge against these enemies a grand and global alliance? Will you join in that historic effort? In the long history of the world, only a few generations have been granted the role of defending freedom in its hour of danger. I do not shrink from this responsibility. I welcome it. I do not believe that any of us would exchange places with any other people or any other generation. The energy, the faith, the devotion which we bring to this endeavor will light our country and all who serve it, and the glow from that fire can truly light the world. So my fellow Americans, ask not what your country can do for you. Ask what you can do for your country. My fellow citizens of the world, ask not America will do for you, but what together we can do for the freedom of man. Now a couple of short quotes from his speech on the space program. He's talking about the fact that some people are saying that things are going too fast, science is progressing too much, maybe we should take a, pause, maybe we should take a rest, and he says, so it is not surprising that some would have a stay where we are a little longer to rest, to wait. But this city of Houston, this state of Texas, this country of the United States was not built by those who waited and rested and wished to look behind them. This country was conquered by those who moved forward, and so will space be conquered. William Bradford, speaking in 1630 of the founding of the Plymouth Bay Colony, said that all great and honorable actions are accompanied with great difficulties, and both must be enterprised and overcome with courage. Those who came before us made certain that this country rode the first wave of the Industrial Revolution, the first wave of modern invention, and the first wave of nuclear power. And this generation does not intend to founder in the backwash of the coming age of space. We mean to be a part of it. We mean to lead, for the eyes of the world now look into space, to the moon, and to the planets beyond. We set sail on this new sea because there is new knowledge to be gained and new rights to be won, and they must be won and used for the progress of all people. For space science, like nuclear science and all technology, has no conscience of its own. Whether it will become a force for good or ill depends upon man. We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon in this decade and to do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard. Because this goal will serve to organize and measure the best of our energies and skills. Because that challenge is one that we are willing to accept, one we are unwilling to postpone, and one which we intend to win, and the others too. It is for these reasons that I regard the decision last year to shift our efforts in space from low gear to high gear as among the most important decisions that will be made during my term in office. Well, I'm not going to read all this, it's getting late. I'll just read the last paragraph. Space is there, and we're going to climb it. And the moon and the planets are there, and new hopes for knowledge and peace are there. And therefore, as we set sail, we ask God's blessing on the most hazardous and dangerous and greatest adventure on which man has ever embarked. So that was in 1962, and a year later, Kennedy was dead. Right? 5 years later, you had the Summer of Love, 2 years after that, Woodstock, and everything you've seen since. And you think of the qualities that he talks about. We go there not because it's easy, because it's hard. We will meet any challenge, any danger. We will lead. We will triumph. Right? And you think of the situation we're in today, where our society is collapsing. Our culture is decadent. We're going into a dark age. We're facing a blowout of the monetary system. And people don't act. Because truth has no meaning. Life has no meaning. The only thing that matters is personal fulfillment, pleasure, the sexual and erotic delicatessen. And it is impossible for us to win this fight unless we understand that and unless we are willing to organize people on that basis. If we just talk to people about New Bretton Woods and the Eurasian land bridge and the new policy, they're not going to do anything. They're not going to do a damn thing. Nothing. Because they're not interested in it. They're interested in what makes them feel good. So that is what has to be addressed in people. You've been brainwashed. You've been corrupted. You know, you belong to a generation which is morally and emotionally retarded and repressed. Your emotional and psychological development never got past the first grade. You're the center of your own universe because of what was done to you and to your generation. And unless we organize people in that way, we are going to be incapable of mobilizing the movement of people we need to win this fight. So, that's all I have to say. We'll just stop right there. Thanks for people. It's a long briefing, I know.